Welcome to Black Onyx, where we're discussing the regulatory topic, conflict of interests. We're chatting with Nikki Visser, who runs operations for Reitway Global. Nikki, thank you for joining us and sharing in your knowledge.
Thank you.
Nikki, in your own words, please describe exactly what is or what is potentially a conflict of interests.
A conflict or potential conflict of interest is when a financial service provider or representative makes a decision that may not be in the best interest of the client. That could be because the financial service provider or representative stands to make a gain, financial or otherwise, at the expense of the client's interests, or if the financial service provider or representative's objectivity has been influenced by a previous relationship with one of the service providers.
To whom does the conflict of interest apply to in your organisation?
So within Reitway, conflict of interest would mainly apply to our investment team. The scenarios would be when they decide in which executing stockbrokers to make use of when trading for the portfolio, if one of those stockbrokers provided gifts or entertainment or any other financial interest to the team, it could be seen as a conflict of interest. Also, when determining which companies to invest in for the portfolio, if, for instance, the investment team invested in a stock after that company provided gifts or entertainment to the team, as well as when the team are trading for their personal account. So if they came across a good prospect and decided to invest in their own personal portfolio and not invested in the Reitway portfolio, that would be a conflict. It could also apply to our product development team when they are deciding which third-party providers to make use of for setting up of new products.
Who is responsible for the compliance of conflict of interest requirements in your organisation?
So we have an internal compliance committee, an external compliance officer, and we have two key individuals who both form part of the investment team. So all these participants would work together to ensure compliance. The internal committee monitors the daily functions within the organisation and would be the first to pick up if there were any potential conflicts. This would be discussed internally and, if need be, with the external compliance officer.
What systems and controls do you have in place within your organisation to manage a conflict of interest or potential one?
We have two key individuals who form part of the investment team. They're involved in all the decision-making processes and thus would have sight of any potential conflicts. So once a month we have a compliance meeting with our external compliance officer, and any concerns that have been picked up would be raised in this meeting and discussed.
Nikki, have you ever discussed a conflict of interest or potential conflict of interest to your organisation?
Yes, we have had a potential conflict of interest a few years ago. One of the portfolio team members participated in a sponsored international property tour. This was discussed at great length with our external compliance officer. It was deemed not to be a conflict, as the tour had no impact on the decision of whether or not to invest in the hosting company. The compliance officer helped us understand the processes regarding conflict of interest. We also had to do research on the specific company of when we had invested, when we had exited and entered that particular stock. After giving all the information to the compliance officer, he was satisfied that it was not a conflict.
Nikki, why is it important to avoid a conflict of interest?
So ultimately, it is to protect the integrity of the financial services industry. It is in the best interest of all participants that investors are confident in the South African financial services industry. The processes of avoiding, mitigating and disclosing instances of actual or potential conflicts serves to foster trust with clients and potential clients.
What financial interest as defined may an FSP or individual receive from a third party?
The financial service providers and representatives may receive fees, commissions or remuneration that is proportionate to the services being provided. They may also accept items of an immaterial financial interest. So that would be items of an aggregate value of less than 1,000 rand within a calendar year.
Does your organisation have a gift register, and how do you monitor it and manage it internally?
So we do have a gift register. It is the responsibility of all employees to ensure that the gift register is updated. All the employees at Reitway have written the phased regulatory exams, so they understand the regulations and the responsibilities. If an employee had to receive a gift, they would notify me. I would then update the register and review it to determine whether there are any potential conflicts. So should I review the gift register and determine there is a potential conflict, we would do an internal investigation with the internal compliance committee to gather all the facts surrounding the incident. Once our internal investigation is complete, we would then decide if we needed to escalate to the external compliance officer for input as to whether or not a conflict or potential conflict exists.
Does your organization ensure that all your employees are trained up and understand a conflict of interest?
So as previously mentioned, all of our employees have written the phased regulatory exams, so they are aware of the regulations. We also have a monthly compliance meeting where various compliance issues are discussed. Then we have a conflict of interest management policy, which is updated and signed by all employees on an annual basis. So they are aware of conflict of interest on an ongoing basis, as well as we have quarterly declarations, compliance declarations. So employees need to sign this declaration stating that they are not aware of any potential conflicts. This is then sent to our external compliance officer. We also, as previously mentioned, the investment team are the most likely to be faced with conflict of interest. And these are professionals in the industry who understand the topic. They are also all affiliated with the CFA Institute, either as charter holders, members or candidates. They therefore subscribe to the CFA's code of ethics as well.
Nikki, what are the penalties and fines applicable for non-compliance?
So there are no specific fines or penalties for non-compliance relating to conflict of interest. However, it does fall under the fines and penalties of the FASE Act. So contraventions of the FASE Act have a maximum penalty of 10 million rand or 10 years imprisonment or both. The actual penalty would depend on the severity of the transgression.
Nikki, thank you very much for joining us today and sharing your knowledge and our better understanding on the conflict of interest policy. And thank you for tuning into Black Onyx. For more details, please visit our website.